is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Record with Zhivargo Laing is sponsored by Royal Fidelity Bank and Trust, Royal Star Assurance, Fidelity Bank Bahamas, BTC, the Cleveland Clinic, and the Insurance Commission of the Bahamas.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you join us here today on Guardian Radio, 96 FM, on this beautiful Tuesday afternoon, where we're going to have in our first hour a discussion with some very special guests of mine. I'll introduce them in a minute. You can call us today at some point on any of the following numbers, 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796 or WhatsApp me on 439-3043. We are, of course, live on Cable Bahamas, channel 969, where my mother listens to the show, or you can catch us on BTC 612. It is my distinct pleasure to have with us Allison Maynard Gibson, QC, attorney, former Minister of Financial Services and former Attorney General, Member of Parliament and Senator in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, and now the chair of the Board of Trustees of the University of the Bahamas. And she is joined today by Mr. Barry Rassen. Mr. Rassen, I hope I don't have your resume not updated, but I believe he remains the president of Doctors Hospital Systems and is certainly well known in the Rotary circles for his work there. Welcome, lady. Welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you for having us, Mr. Laing. And you mentioned your mom listening. I give her a special shout out. And she helped me to cut my political teeth.
She did it for so many. But she always listens. She always calls me when she thinks people have been picking on me and say, "What you think wrong with them?"
That's a mother loving her son.
But Madam Chair, we are so delighted to have you and Mr. Rassen with us today to talk about an institution which, personally speaking, for myself and so many others, a place of our beginnings, a place that has nurtured our academic and social development and that has made a massive contribution to the development of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, again, has so much potential. And we're talking about, at first, the College of the Bahamas, established in the 1970s, and now the University of the Bahamas trying to move on to the next level. And you have the responsibility of leading the strategic body responsible for the furtherance of the university's development. Now, first of all, let me ask you, how has it been coming into this new responsibility?
Very, very exciting and very humbling, both at the same time. I want to say that, as you have pointed out, we are standing on the shoulders of all of those who went before and have made such a remarkable legacy. We think of people like yourself and many others who have come through the COB system. Now we're a university and moving forward to another level, standing on their shoulders. And then also, it was a privilege of leading the board comprised of, like Mr. Rassen, a former, not only a Paul Harris Fellow, but the president of Rotary International. So that shows you the acclaim that the whole world has for him. Mm-hmm. So to be serving on a board with people like him is also exciting and humbling. So it's exciting times. We just have looking forward to leaning in on the Bahamian public to fully the vision that the people themselves, when the legislators passed the University of Bahamas Act, had in mind for our country and our university.
You know, when I speak with you, I have to say, I get a very real sense that you seem to appreciate the magnificentiality of the University of the Bahamas and its broader, more national and global potential contribution. Am I reading you? A sense I get in listening to you when you and I have had opportunities to speak.
Absolutely. I mean, the thing about it is the people of the Bahamas, through their legislators, decided in 2016 that we would have a national university. So our people recognize the importance of a national university, and in our statute to drive national development. Those words are actually in the statute. And so it's our job every day to think about how do we accomplish these things. It's our fiduciary responsibility, trustees given to us by the people of the Bahamas. And also it's our duty to serve the generation coming behind us to help them become good citizens and also equipped to drive national development. And I want to say to you, the entire board takes this responsibility very seriously.
And the board, you know, the university has an executive team that includes the president, the executive vice president, and all the vice presidents and others. But then there is this board of trustees. Can you help people appreciate the role and function of the board of trustees?
Sure. It's just like a board of directors of any company. You would have your CEO and your CFO and your COO, the executives of the company. But the board itself sets policy. It makes sure that the company's on the right track, accounts to the shareholders, those kinds of things. So we're really basically the people who drive policy and are responsible for accounting to our shareholders, the Bahamian people, for the direction of the university. And is it actually carrying out its mission?
So, and to that extent, then, I imagine that the board is largely responsible for championing and even perhaps facilitating the development of the strategic plan for the university?
Absolutely. And that is done. Kudos to the last board and previous ones as well that have consulted. Our citizens should understand it's not done in some room someplace. It's done in consultation with stakeholders in the university, including citizens of our country. And so, yes, we, meaning all of us, have to help to shape our strategic plan because it's the national university.
And given that you've been in the role a short time now, help us appreciate what the vision, what is that thing that the strategy is ultimately trying to achieve at the university?
Ultimately, we would like to see produced out of our university educated citizens in the widest sense, understand the responsibility of citizenship in its widest sense, and are able to become productive citizens of the world. That's the big, big, in my words, mission. But I mean, if you would allow me to say some things that we are, and as we come down as to how we're going to implement, there's some things that we are driven to do in the short
term. Please, go right ahead.
So we want to see to it that the University of the Bahamas is accredited internationally, pursuing accreditation of the Southern Association of Colleges and Schools, the acronym is SACS. This is one of the regional bodies in the United States, and it is one of the most competitive of the regional bodies for university accreditation. It is held in such high esteem that universities in the Middle East and South and Central America are also seeking SACS accreditation. And this is important because it means if you, anybody who's graduating from our university and who is applying for a job, let's say, with someone from Vanderbilt or University of Miami or any other SACS-accredited institution, the employer can understand when the person took these courses, they were taught in a particular way, particular standards had to be met, and so forth and so on. So you're comparing apples and apples. You don't have to explain anything. And it opens doors for our graduates. It's important. And we also have to, on a regular basis, seek reaccreditation.
I'm sorry, Chair, but that's interesting and important because, you know, today, like those of us who have been at, who are at the College of the Bahamas have been able to have our credits transferred to top universities around, but those universities themselves would have done the assessments of our credits and said, okay, yes, we accept these. What you're saying is through this accreditation process, there's a kind of instant recognition that comes to that credit and to that graduate because of its affiliation and accreditation in this regional body.
With SACS. And then I wonder whether or not you would allow Mr. Rassen, who has just had Doctors Hospital, I shouldn't say just, but Doctors Hospital is also accredited, and he could possibly, in a very practical way, explain also what it means.
Absolutely, please.
Just to correct you, I'm no longer president of Doctors Hospital.
Okay.
I don't want Dr. Charles Diggers to think I'm coming back.
Thank you for correcting it.
He's doing a great job. But to me, this is a really exciting time for the university. This is an opportunity for the board to really transition a college into a university, which will have a transformative impact on the country. This isn't just about one organization. This is about transforming a country. I remember going through the accreditation process at Doctors Hospital. It took about 10 years from the time we said we have to do it and we started the process and before we finally got an accredited body to accept that and give us accreditation. It's a long, hard road, but what it does is it puts policies into place that are right, that are ethical, that will help drive the success of the organization. It helps individuals in the organization know exactly what needs to be done and how it needs to be done. So it becomes a driving force for quality education. I'm a personal believer that education should be one of our number one priorities in this country. And for the university to get accredited, that's a great step forward towards showing that it truly is a priority and it's going to make a big total.
You know, I really like the perspective you just drew on because it's something that I have had to try to use in another area of life in the country where you're saying, listen, yes, you get at the end of the day, but after an accreditation, you get this recognition. But the process drives you to change yourself into a worthy institution for that accreditation.
Exactly right. And that's why it's so critical.
Yeah.
That we do this and we make the individuals better, the organization better, the country better.
Yeah.
World class. You've used the word world class many, many times. And so when you think about the way your iPad or your phone works or the worldwide, the rules that apply internationally in international spaces, there's no such thing as Bahamian excellence, you know. Excellence is excellence wherever you encounter it in the world. Mm-hmm. And accreditation enables us to, each of us to acknowledge that.
Mm-hmm. And now you mentioned accreditation as a key and critical thing to see you're seeking to achieve, but you wanted to speak about some other things you're trying to do.
Yeah, we are going to, as you know, we've acquired or about to complete our acquisition of a new campus in Freeport, downtown Freeport, the Kipling Building, the entire complex. That will become our STEM campus, engineering and math. We are busy striking alliances with the industrial complex in Grand Bahama and also tech people in the Bahamas. And so we want them to be involved in making sure, again, that our graduates are able to walk in straight in the door to obtain jobs with people in the Bahamas and elsewhere in the world as well. We are also, very importantly, getting up to date, thanks to those trustees, Philip Stubbs and his team, who are working on that to get that sorted out. And if you could envisage the complex that is the sporting complex and the stadium, we are committed to implementing a vision of the previous board two boards ago, to a few boards ago, to convert that into a PPP, public-private sector partnership, that will enable those facilities used year-round for them to be revenue-generating, that will help the university become self-sustaining. One of the final things I do want to mention, there are many others as well. We want to become a preeminent center of excellence for research. And one of the ways that we're going to do that is to work with the government, establish a policy whereby research that is conducted in the Bahamas is to be conducted in conjunction with the University of the Bahamas. So the many, you know from your position, a former life that you had, Mr. Laing, that there are a lot of things going on in the research sphere in the Bahamas that we don't know anything about. Mm-hmm. As a matter of law and policy, that'll be changed and it'll be channeled through University of Bahamas.
When we have to take a break, but when we come back, I want to ask you to turn your attention to the Nassau Space and Center that the university now occupies, because many people have asked whether there is a vision to kind of turn the immediate vicinity space in Nassau into kind of like a university town, et cetera. But when we come back, I'll ask you to turn your attention to that. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad to have with us today Mrs. Allison Maynard Gibson, the chair of the Board of Trustees of the University of the Bahamas, and one of the members of that board, Mr. Barry Rass. And when we come back, we'll continue our discussion. We'll be back after this break.
Debate about is that BTC has the best rates. Now, the best rates just got better because you pay half the price of the other guys with your BTC home internet and mobile services combined. Switching to BTC is a no-brainer because I pay less with BTC and get super fast internet with speeds up to 600 megs. The other guys, their internet only go up to 105 megs.
Get all the internet you want at half the price when you bundle your home internet and mobile. Visit a BTC store to make the switch today. Conditions apply.
How important collecting your money can be to the success of your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services. From click and pay options online to merchant terminals and e-commerce options, we're here to help your business succeed. From our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport, visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
Sheila, you okay? I see smoke coming from your window.
Chad, Johnny Moe's burning down the house frying chicken.
Your kitchen is a mess. You have insurance?
If I have insurance, pull my phone out, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and in no time, I was on live chat with RSA rep, sent pics of the damage, filed my claim on the spot.
Wow, I don't think my insurance got that kind of...
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
I'm not afraid, I'm not a mistake. Take a stand, everybody.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM as we speak with the chair of the Board of Trustees of Bahamas, Mrs. Allison Maynard Gibson QC, and with another member of the board, Mr. Barry Rasson. And we're talking about the university's forward-looking strategy. Before the break, I was asking about the plans for the Nassau Center and whether this question that people raise from time to time about the university's interest in kind of turning that whole sphere around it, town center.
You're absolutely right. And I would like, if you don't mind, Mr. Rasen also to give a perspective. In the medical arena, you will have seen how, because of the Doctors Hospital and Princess Margaret coming together, how so much of Shirley Street area and Palmdale has changed. So he can give some practical examples, and the same thing is happening in Grand Bahama. But on the university side, if we can imagine, we go to university towns like Cambridge, Massachusetts, for example. I would spend 2019 at Harvard. It's a university town. Everything surrounds the university, right? And if we, as we develop our university and develop its infrastructure, we can completely see the entire Bain and Grantstown area all the way down to Nassau Street, around to your Big Pond area, Yellow Elder area, coming around the back there by Howell Road. That entire 450 acres on that backside there, by heading towards so the sporting complex, all of that, right? Once that's now being utilized, not only by university students, our university students, but also those abroad, and most importantly, in my spirit, our students in primary school students and high school students who on weekends and after school come to sports in that arena and come to marching band and come to cheerleading. These kinds of activities are so wholesome that in the long term, we actually decrease, I believe, and we'll do some studies on this, gang membership, right? Because kids would much rather be involved in that kind of thing. And then everything that goes with it in the surrounding environment as well. It's like a rising tide, rising all boats, not just one or two boats. And for the children, if they're there, they're thinking about, wow, I'm really enjoying this kind of thing. But what does it take for me to be able to, you know, go come to you, come and participate in this all the time? Well, get into University of the Bahamas. What does it take for me to get into university school? So there's this whole completely transformative impact that is so important once we all get involved and we all unite behind this, our common, the shared vision.
You know, it's very interesting that you mentioned that. I have a youth leadership development program. And
right.
For years, I took young leaders into Atlanta, and part of our visit was to for them to tour universities. We went to Georgia Tech University on several occasions, and one of the points that Georgia Tech made was they have a policy. The policy is what, and they had like $1 billion worth of infrastructural development going on. Their policy is a certain percentage of that, the labor and stuff from that, businesses from that, had to go to the surrounding neighborhoods and peoples.
Absolutely.
They also did this. They found out that a number of people who had been incarcerated were finding themselves blocked from being able to get jobs when it was taking, developments were taking place. And so they changed their policy to remove the, have you ever been in prison?
Yeah, the check the box thing.
Right. So you know, this is how, just to your point, how they become part of the life of the surrounding area. Mm-hmm. Mr. Aston?
Sorry, I don't think everybody appreciates in the community that when you have a university community, not just a university you go to, you do academics, you get a good education, absolutely important. But really what you need to focus on is the whole experience of the student and the faculty during that time at university, because their experience shapes them as an individual. Sure, it educates them. Sure, it gets them ready for their career. But more than that, it shapes them ethically, morally, everything that to do with a character, so that when you are out there in life, you're ready for whatever comes at you. And you're not just focused on one aspect of an education. That, I think, is the importance of having a university. And while we have a great opportunity to do that right here in Nassau, we also have a great opportunity to do that in Freeport. And what's going to happen is you're going to see, again, a transformation of Freeport because of it. And you could see a transformation here because the education now becomes an important aspect of education.
I have to ask you, Madam Chair, the university is also making a substantial transition. You announced it. It's taking on a new a new leadership, new president. Would you care to speak to that?
Yep. I'd like to speak to the process. When the previous board found itself faced with the need to find a new president because the existing president was transitioning, a presidential search committee was comprised of not only university people, but people from the community as well. The community was also consulted, and other stakeholders in the university and outside were consulted on what was it that they thought would be ideal. And that is what the profile of the president, that's how the profile of the presidential profile was shaped. A significant advertising process, I think it was, Barry, was it 74 or 94? But a lot of people, almost 100 people. 94, almost 100 people applied. We came down, by the time I became the chair, it had been shortlisted to 3. And the board took very seriously the need to really, continuing with stakeholders to really examine all of the 3 candidates. We asked the stakeholders how they felt about them. We spoke with them. We consulted internationally with governing boards and so forth about university governing boards about what we should be doing to carry out our fiduciary responsibility. We wanted to be sure that the process was unimpeachable. And the board came down in favor of Dr. Eric Rowland for many reasons. One is that he had already taken his university through the accreditation process, which, as Mr. Rasmussen has already told you, is heavy lifting. It affects every single aspect of the institution. So in every part of the university from top to bottom will be impacted. And he had already done this, so we don't need to reinvent wheels. Also, he's very, very heavily tech-oriented, heavily oriented also in for venture capital and fundraising, had systems oriented, making sure that faculty grants, we need to make sure that we get faculty grants so that we're going to become a research center so they can actually have time to conduct research. There were just a lot of compelling reasons for Dr. Rowland. And we didn't need to reinvent any wheel. And so those were the reasons that he was chosen after an unimpeached process was followed.
And he takes office in August, right?
Yes, August 1st, Dr. Smith ends his tenure at the university, his distinguished tenure, on July 31st, and Dr. Rowland commences on August 1st.
And you also had some other movements also because now you have the new president who will be coming in and you have Dr. Ian Strawn, who's now the executive vice president.
Yes, he is. As of April 1st, Dr. Strawn is the executive vice president of the University of Bahamas, and he will continue to have responsibility as president of UB North.
And so you're now through your appointment, hopefully, putting a big effort and resource behind one of the things that you find most critical, which is the achievement of accreditation.
We're putting a lot of resources behind it, but we're not only doing that. We are also, as I said, I named some other things we're doing. We're going to be doing. We don't believe in either or. The entire board is really enthusiastic and firm about this. So we're doing accreditation and other things. Right. Our strategic plan is on the website, and we've also been very determined about making sure that UB, on the UB's website, we've also been very determined to make sure that what we're doing is publicized. So please feel free to consult frequently about it.
Mr. Rasmussen, one of the things that I know is true about accreditation processes is that they are very data-driven. You have to manifest your progress in actual evidence and stuff like that. One of the things I know that the university does is treats its strategic plan in relation to data driving too. So whether that relates to student data or achievement data, et cetera, that's important, right?
Absolutely. The technology and the ability to measure whatever you're doing. You can't just tell the accreditation folks we're doing it. You got to prove it. You got to show them with the numbers that every policy is followed, who's following it, they're actually, and you have to also use that data to make sure that it is widely disseminated, because the accreditation people could go to any student and ask them, well, is this really happening in this university? So you've got to have the data. You've got to be able to disseminate the data. The great thing is we already have a great department at the university that handles statistics, and I know they can do a great job with this. We just need to make sure they're focused on the accreditation regulations.
And also beef them up to give and make sure that everybody, one of the things that as Mr. Rasina said, we don't just talk about it. We need to make sure that we equip the relevant areas with the resources that are needed to meet the highest standards, right? And secondly, we can't say enough that this whole concept of shared governance is so critically important, not just amongst university stakeholders, but in terms of making sure that the citizens of our country are constantly aware of what is happening at UB, why citizens are an important part of UB, businesses, when they want to have research done, et cetera, the go-to should be UB. So UB is really a part of everyday life in our country, and we want to make sure that there's that consciousness UB is in the front of everybody's mind.
You mentioned, Madam Chair, the need to produce graduates at the university who can excel, and these were your words, a little paraphrased, excel at home, and which to me says you have a more expansive understanding or perspective on what a Bahamian citizen ought to be equipped to do. When we come back from the break, I want to ask you to please talk to us about that in the context of the focus of the university on its students and their development. We'll be back after this break, ladies and gentlemen. You're listening to Z Live. I'm here speaking with Mrs. Allison Maynard Gibson, Chair of the Board of Trustees of the University of Bahamas, and Mr. Barry Rasson, Member of the Board of Trustees. We'll be back after this break.
Everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. Send you know that you're not alone.
If you're looking to diversify your portfolio, chart a course for RF Mutual Funds, where you can get global returns through our suite of internationally invested funds. Get exposure in U.S., Asian, European, and emerging markets without central bank approval. And with financial services leader Morgan Stanley as the advisor of our international funds, you can benefit from RF's global connections to the markets today by visiting rfgroup.com. RF, money at work.
Samantha's always on point. She doesn't miss a thing. When she signs up for any insurance policy, she reads all the fine print. She knows what's covered, what's not covered, and she's aware of her deductibles. When it comes to insurance, it pays to know your policy. Review every insurance policy so you know what you're covered for. This message was brought to you by the Insurance Commission of the Bahamas.
One thing there is no debate about is that BTC has the best rates. Now, the best rates just got better because you pay half the price of the other guys with your BTC home internet and mobile services combined. Switching to BTC is a no-brainer because I pay less with BTC and get super fast internet with speeds up to 600 megs. The other guys, their internet only go up to 105 megs.
Get all the internet you want at half the price when you bundle your home internet and mobile. Visit a BTC store to make the switch today. Conditions apply.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Nassau, Bahamas.
Not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. Send you know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I'm here speaking with Mrs. Allison Maynard Gibson, Chair of the Board of Trustees of the University of the Bahamas, and Mr. Barry Rasson, a member of the Board of Trustees. We're talking about the university's thrust and direction into the future. I was asking about students. You know, one of the things that impressed me when I first joined UB And I give credit to Dr. Rodney Smith in the emphasis he placed on it that I recognize was that the clients of the university are its students. And they are actually, they are the proof of what it has done. And so as I indicated, you say you're trying to prepare these students, not just for the Bahamas, but for the world. And that to me is a new emphasis because many a times, you know, I hear, you know, key to Bahamas for Bahamians, or you got, that's what you're doing, right? Can you help us with that perspective?
Yes, thank you for that opportunity. When you think of what is it that a Bahamian can't do? I don't think you can name anything that a Bahamian cannot do. And that is the indomitable spirit that we want to tap into as we take our university to the next level. We have the most Rhodes scholars per capita, with focusing only on academics, and we can go on. The point is that this can be done, and we want to be very intentional about it. Accreditation has us recognizing that, hey, excellence, the highest standards, whatever is produced out of University of Bahamas meets the standards of Duke, Vanderbilt, University of Miami, these schools that I'm naming, we all recognize these names as the new, they are accredited by SACS. Okay, and there are many, many others. And so Bahamians then will be able to walk into an interview anywhere in the world and be regarded as the same as a student, a graduate from any of those named universities. That is extremely important in today's world where, you know, we have geographical boundaries, but our young children, because of the internet, don't even relate to those. They're taught geography, but the reality is that they're communicating and they recognize, and parents recognize, that their children are competing with children from all over the world. It is our responsibility to prepare our students for this world.
You are also, and you've mentioned it a couple of times, you're also trying to prepare the University of the Bahamas to be a option and a serious option for students of the world.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, we see as we move forward, and our board is quite serious about this, marine biology, for example, as an example. My puppy is agreeing with you, sorry. Marine biology and so forth. These are logical. We have our ship building repair facility here. Just think of, Zhivargo, you're familiar with the whole Grand Bahama scene. Mm-hmm. Investing in that Freeport campus, you could imagine people from around the world coming here to that Freeport campus, or to the Freeport campus also for STEM. If the Marine Biology Center is also established in Grand Bahama, students will come also to study there, and not just come, but COVID has taught us, has pushed us into the whole online education experience. So absolutely, yes, we expect that, and we are being very intentional about throwing courses open to students from around the world and being able to exchange programs. We have articulation agreements and so forth that we intend to fully utilize the potential in all of these tools. And the executive at UB have there. These are all tools that are there. We want to maximize their use.
It's interesting, you know, a university, I remember having the provost, former provost of the university, Dr. Linda Davis, on the show. And we were talking, at the time, the university was engaging a number of international persons at various posts. And we were talking about some of the pushback that was happening around those appointments. And she was one of the persons who was pointing out to me, you know, the word university is a notion that suggests that you have a universe of diversity on the campus, in thought, in ethnicity, and all these kinds of things, because that's the kind of environment that you're trying to foster. Do you think it's important, and how important is it for people to understand that when you are calling yourself a university, you are really saying this and that typically apply, don't really apply here?
Extremely important. The nature of the academy is that you encourage thought. It's a petri dish almost, where you can actually, you push your students to think. Of course, you don't ignore the masters that have gone before, but we're not living in the past. We're building on past, present, and future. We're looking forward. And so in this environment, artificial boundaries, race, color, sexual orientation, et cetera, they have no place there, none. This is where we explore ideas. We explore nation building. We explore excellence. We explore world citizenship and so forth. So we want our students to be completely open-minded and able, and our faculty as well, and able to sit with a student from Oxford University, from Harvard University, and talk about whatever concept is being spoken about at the time. Barry, what do you think?
I was going to say it goes to the experience I talked about earlier. When you bring in that internationality to the campus, now you greatly increased the ability for our local students to enhance their international understanding. And again, it gives them a bigger perspective of what the world's all about and what their possibility is all about. And they suddenly look to doing bigger and better things.
So for our articulation agreements, we really would like to see, to see some masters abroad become almost standard. Because even if students, let's say another student, an international student never came, although international students have been coming to UB for quite some time. You remember the School of Hospitality was well established and people were coming from Nigeria. So it's not new to College of the Bahamas or UB. But even if another one never came, we want to be sure that we also send our students on semesters abroad. Because that also exposes them and changes their exposure, changes their mindset, and enhances their life, you know?
The interesting thing about a university campus, too, is that notwithstanding the liberalization of ideas or the openness of ideas, the university says you have to check those ideas against the evidence, against the research, against what we actually know. The difference between an opinion and what is and can be an established fact through research, which could also change through better research, etc. So you're not just letting people free, you're letting them free to explore research evidence-based ideas.
Yep, and that's those sort of standards as well. I mean, at the end of the day, you have to pass tests and you have to meet certain requirements so that when you leave with your certificate or when you leave with your diploma or when you leave with your degree, it means something anywhere you go in the world.
I have someone here texting, says, I don't understand how we can get that, meaning the things you want, when we don't have infrastructure similar to Ivy Leagues.
Remember that the Ivy Leagues didn't always have the infrastructure that they have. And also, you grow into that. And we're talking about a vision. And we don't have to have all of that today to enable students to excel. We don't. What we do need is to get our accreditation in place so that it is all understood.
So Laing, can you please ask the chairman of the board is the university still partnering with a company to do a convention center and something else? The new dorms and a convention center?
I understand that this plan exists. I haven't seen it yet. And so I'll be able to answer that once I've seen that and understand whether that's on the table.
Okay, this text is for Laing. I'm a graduate from the university just recently. I love that institution. Can you ask Ms. Maynard Gibson why UB's audits were backlogged and also the financial statements are not up to date, and how does that affect funding?
It does affect funding very dramatically. Not only are we legally bound to present our audits within a certain period of time, but it's very difficult to raise money when you can't account for your stewardship of the money that you've been given. Happily, as I indicated, which had not been in place since 2012, we expect through the wonderful efforts, the yeoman efforts of members of the board and also some of the executive team working with our auditors, we expect by the end of the year to be actually up to date.
Wow, okay. Wonderful. Well, I know your time is limited and we've got like 2 minutes left, so I wanted to give you the opportunity, both of you, to give us your final thoughts for the day.
I'm going to give it over to Barry because he has he has something to say, and he's just a Rotary International. We gotta honor that.
I just want to add that we actually are meeting with our auditors on a weekly basis right now so that we can make sure they are up to date, and that is critical for everything we do. We have to also encourage our community to appreciate that we need donations. A university, any university, not only has their tuitions, but also has many donations from very generous donors. And so we have a program to go after them and speak with them and help them understand how important growth and accreditation is so they support us. This is a very exciting time for the country, for our university to be doing what we're doing. It's just an honor to be a part of it, working with our incredible chair.
Chair, you got a promise to come back. Yes,
I'd love to come back. But I do want to say that we've asked you, Mr. Laing, as the head of the Government and Public Policy Institute at the University of the Bahamas, to actually, as we come into our 50th anniversary of independence, to conduct other kinds of studies that you do. These are totally independent, engaging society, whichever society, national and international, depending on the topic, to discuss broadly what does Bahamianization mean in the 21st century. And so I want to thank you, Mr. Laing, for agreeing through your institute to actually have those kinds of discussions that are extremely important, not just not only to our nation, but also to our university. And we're very happy that it's happening in the university context. So thank you for all that you're doing to help to grow our university and through our university, our nation.
We have initiated the process, ma'am.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have been speaking with the chair of the Board of Trustees of the University of the Bahamas, Mrs. Allison Maynard Gibson, QC, and Mr. Barry Rassen, a member of the trustees. We hopefully get them back. We're going to take a break for news. And when we come back, we're going to hop on some other topics. We'll be back.
Thanks for having us. Thanks very much.
You're very welcome. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Tuesday afternoon. If you want to give us a call, the numbers to do so are 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us at 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. You know, in the context of the discussions I just had with the chair of the Board of Trustees of the University of the Bahamas and a member of the board and all that the University of the Bahamas represents. So I have a question for you, right? I have a question for you. We've been talking about the age of consent. We've been seeing children abused, even killed. We've been talking about young people getting into violent activities and criminal activities, et cetera, and so forth. And yet at the same time, we know we have university students who are graduating regularly and going out there and making a positive contribution to the world. But let me ask you a question, right? What does it take to raise a functional, moral, ethical, forward-thinking, compassionate, loving, sensible child in this period in which we live? What does it take to do that? Because I want to ask, like, could there be a more important question on planet Earth than that today? Because in essence, all the challenges and all the opportunities that will exist in our world, they will be handed over to all the children that we are growing to become adults in the world. If a child is zero today, 18 years, 19 years, 20 years down the line, all the challenges, all the opportunities are theirs. But what does it take to raise a child? Like me, like, I'm almost out of the business now, almost. I ain't quite there, right? I've got two that's adults now. And let me tell you something. When kids turn adult, my own mindset is, yes, you can still parent them, but you ain't parenting them the way you were parenting them when they were children. They are adults. They choose if they want to be in your life or not. I don't think some parents understand that. Let me tell you something. When a child reaches a certain psychological and mental development, they are not in your life because they must be. They are in your life because they choose to be. And whether they choose to be may very well depend on the relationship you all and them have had over the period of time when they felt that they had to be in your life, because that's where they was getting fed, that's where they were getting clothed, that's where they were getting sheltered, that's where they were getting some care and affection, they thought, and so forth and so forth. But after that period of time, when they think that they man and woman life, you could get vexed and mad all you want. They choose to be in your life. And you know how it goes. Eventually, you don't hear from them that much. When you hear from them, maybe something gone wrong. They call you when they want to call you. It could be a month later, 2 months, 10 months later, 3 days later. But it's up to them. Right? But they get to inherit the planet and all of its issues. They get to be the ones who have to live with all the other children that were raised to be adults with all their attitudes and all their perspectives and all their ideas and thoughts. What does it take to raise? Well, I don't even use the word raise anymore, because you raise herds. You raise cattle. You don't raise human beings. I learned that from a guru. We don't raise human beings. You help human beings come into their space in the universe. What does it take to do that in a way where they are thinking right? And what is right? Where they are acting right? And what is right acting? Where they are doing right? And what is doing right? Where they are functional and productive and positive contributors to the planet. Let me tell you all something. Some of us are angry and upset that some of our young people act the way they act. And we don't realize that through our own behavior and example and teaching, we are creating two kinds of people in the world. We are creating people who are, well, actually three kinds. People who are totally consumed with extracting things from people and things and the world, and people who are totally committed to contributing to people and the world, and then people who have a mixture of both. They are the extractors. Everything they see in the world, every relationship, every reaction they have, every involvement they have. It's what I can get out of it. What can I get out of it? What can I get out of it? What can I get meaning? And then you have contributors who say, you know what? I want to give something to the world. I want to be a positive contribution. I want to make a contribution to this place. And then you got people who know sometimes I extract and sometimes I contribute. Those kinds of people you get in the world. Let me tell you something. If you want to know something true about extractors, extractors benefit themselves, but their contribution to the world is always waste. What? Okay, when you extract from the world food and energy and what have you, you extract that, put it into your system, what comes out? Whatever is used to benefit you, what comes out afterwards? What do you contribute afterwards? Waste. Now you take a plant. The plant is a producer. It takes your waste or the waste we have and it uses the waste to produce. It's a producer. So you can tell extractors put out a lot of poop. Producers, they put out a lot of fruit. Poop, fruit. So if you want to understand, if you want to know if you're an extractor, if you're putting out into the world a lot of nonsense, a lot of crap, a lot of bad vibes, a lot of hatred and them kind of things, you are an extractor and you are only extracting and as a result, producing waste in the end. Alternatively, the producers, they actually take them bad vibes. They actually take them bad attitudes and they think about ways in which they can show and demonstrate empathy and compassion and goodwill and try to put out into the world some fruits of patience, of long suffering, of kindness, of gentleness, of humility, and so forth, to try to make the world a more flowered, fruitful place. What does it take to raise a child? Well, not raise a child, sorry, to help to nurture a child in this period of time in which we find ourselves, a very complex seeming time. I mean, it's like in all kinds of ways, it's an unsettled, uncertain time, a time of plenty, but a time of significant lack, a time of great advancement, but a time of seeming in human relations and behavior and conduct. What does it take to help these children nurture themselves to grow and develop to be a positive force on the planet? I should find another topic. We should talk about the Coalition for Independence and their protest of the people being evicted from the Crown land. We should talk about that. Or maybe we ain't finished with Bill Smith yet slapping Chris Rock. Should I talk about that? Or maybe we should talk some more about the age of consent. I'm giving you some time to think about it. We're going to take a break, and then when we come back, maybe some of y'all have some thoughts about what it takes. Aren't many of you raising children? Have you not many of you raised? Well, let me stop using the word. Nurture children, help them come along. When we come back, maybe you'll say something and help us, give us some guidance. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo, Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break.
Take a stand, take a stand.
Marsh the car. The lady run into me, marsh the car.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
Know how important collecting your money can be to the success of your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services. From click and pay options online to merchant terminals and e-commerce options, we're here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business developers 364 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
Around the world, Cleveland Clinic is recognized as a leader in healthcare. Our team of experts relentlessly pursues the best for our patients. From groundbreaking cancer research to state-of-the-art heart surgery, life-saving innovations happen here every day. When it's time to travel for your health, it's time to travel to Cleveland Clinic, your destination for care, for every care in the world. To learn more, visit clevelandclinic.org/Caribbean.
One thing there is no debate about is that BTC has the best rates. Now, the best rates just got better because you pay half the price of the other guys with your BTC home internet and mobile services combined. Switching to BTC is a no-brainer because I pay less with BTC and get super fast in up to 600 megs. The other guys, their internet only go up to 105 megs.
Get all the internet you want at half the price when you bundle your home internet and mobile. Visit a BTC store to make the switch today. Conditions apply.
If you're looking to diversify your portfolio, chart a course for RF Mutual Funds, where you can get global returns through our suite of internationally invested funds. Get exposure in U.S., Asian, European, and emerging markets without central bank approval. And with financial services leader Morgan Stanley as the advisor of our international funds, you can benefit from RF's global connections. Set sail for international markets today by visiting rfgroup.com. RF, money at work.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
I'm not afraid, to take a stand, Everybody, come take my hand, We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live, I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, where in the second half of the show, we're asking the question, you know, we just talked about the University of Bahamas, where all these wonderful young Bahamians are going to try and get themselves an education to help advance their lives. But I'm asking the question, what does it take to nurture a child, a young person, to function in our world today as it is? See, we could want the world to be a certain way, but it is what it is. That's the reality. And you don't get the luxury of living today in the world you want to live in. You have to live in the world that exists today. So what does it take to nurture a child in that world? I have a text here that says, good day, very interesting conversation. I'm 30-something who decided a few years ago after helping my parents bring up younger siblings that parenthood just isn't for me. Wow, okay. I had a lot of strange feelings about some decisions my parents made when I was younger. However, I started having to adult a lot of it made sense, but it's just so hard. Wow. Says, I wonder often how people are able to bring up children while also trying to navigate life. That is really, really something. Thank you for sharing that, right? It's kind of force a habit, right? I have four children, three of them males, and one daughter. So my wife and I have had to nurture them, and so two of them are graduates of university now and working human beings. One is third year university, but also working as she is in university and actually in a leadership role. And then I have a 13-year-old who I hear from people all the time thinks he's something unique, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And I think we ought to think through this question systematically. And I agree with the texter that rearing or nurturing children can be a challenge. It can be, especially if your socioeconomic circumstances are difficult, if the environment in which you find yourself is difficult. And we thinking about the Bahamas, and we think about we are not unemployed. I mean, think about the people have to nurture their children in the environments of a Ukraine, in a sub-Saharan Africa, or somewhere in some of the slums of Rio, and so forth, right? Come on, man. Some of the hamlets of India, right? I want you to imagine that you are dropped into a country you've never been before. Just dropped, and like that, you just find yourself there, right? You've never been there before. Just you're there. What is the first thing that you need to even hope to survive in that place? What do you need? Somebody tell me. But thinking about what you need to do in helping a child to develop in this environment, the answer comes through this. What do you need to do? You just got dropped into this strange country. And you find yourself there in the middle of whatever the heck that is. What do you need first, more than anything else? Somebody venture an answer for me. Somebody said money. No, you don't need money. Mm-mm. You don't need money. Money may come, but that ain't what you need first. What do you need? Don't overthink it. Because food, no, you don't need food. You don't need food, no. Mm-mm. Food is not what you need, no. Not what you need. Somebody said clothing, and it's not clothing either. Not clothing. Because without this thing, all of them becomes difficult. Somebody says a friend. Not quite, but I could see that. And I could see that, and you, when I give you the answer, you see how closely tied it is to that. What do you need? Okay, let me tell you what you need. You need guidance. Guidance. Because guidance tells you where the food is. Guidance tells you where the money is. Guidance tells you where the shelter is. Guidance tells you where the way is. You need guidance. But you ain't likely to meet a friend in a strange country you ain't been to. But a friendly person could provide that guidance. But what you need is guidance. No, you need God, but I'm sorry, I'm talking in practical terms. Let's be real, though. I mean, come on, folks. Let's be real. If you got dropped in a strange country today, you might pray, but come on. Like, you know, we're talking about you need guidance, right? You need guidance. You need guidance, right? Now, you can see how God... Yeah, but see, you're going to see how God comes into play, perhaps, but I want y'all to be practical, right? You need guidance. A child needs guidance in this world. Now, listen to me, folk. Guidance is not shouting at the child. Guidance is not commanding the child. Guidance is a purposeful, directed helping to move in the direction of wellness, better good. You need guidance. And when you ask yourself, okay, this is the world, where's that guidance coming from? Now, generally speaking, the guidance comes from the parent or from the guardian, right? But now here's the critical question. Where are they getting the guidance from? They get it from their parents and their guardians. So now let's go back as far as we could go to all the forefathers who could ever have given guidance. And now let's ask the question, where did the first forefather get his or her guidance? Whatever you think the definition of God is, I just say whatever the definition of creator is, the first guidance should come from creator, right? Because if you put me here, you created me, you know the purpose you put me here for. I hope that the guidance I could get connects me to you, because I believe you know more than anybody else how I work, what I need, how I should function, what this place is that I have been dropped on, and so forth. We need guidance. Children need guidance. Now, if you ain't religious, that's okay. Listen, that's okay. You're not religious. You're not into God. You're not into Christ. You're not into Buddha. You're not into problem. I'll tell you this much. Children need guidance, and you had better hope. You had better hope that the guidance that you have to give them is the guidance they need and require. Because that's important to their being able to function in this world. In a practical way, the last time I checked, ain't too many of us hear God's thundering voice saying to us, Zhivargo, go here, Zhivargo, go there. I'm 54 years old. I gave my heart to the Lord Jesus Christ when I was about 15, 16 years old. And in all that time, listen, I can tell you that I sense what I believe was guidance from God and the voice of God, but I never hear God sit me down and say, listen, Zhivargo, Laing, I'm talking to you now. And that never happened. Many, many, many times in my life, the guidance came from talking to my mother, from talking to some elderly person, from talking to some other person, or from reading the scriptures, or from getting some information out of a book I read, or from a teacher or something like that. That's how but you need guidance. Ladies and gentlemen, you mothers, you fathers out there, you parents, you guardians, you uncles, you aunts, I'm asking you to check yourself and me check eyes that are given to our children. From whence cometh that guidance, and how robust and how credible is that guidance? Right? And if you don't know, go try to know. Don't pretend. A parent don't know everything. A parent doesn't have to be certain about everything. It's okay to tell your kids, listen, can I check this out for you? That's the kind of conversations I have. My kids, sons ask me stuff sometimes. I don't know the answer. I tell them this, let's go check this out and see if we can find out how this goes. They need guidance. I can't stress this enough. Listen to me, folks. Listen to me. You know, adults, you know this world is very complicated, man. Especially in negotiating life with other human beings, with all their complexities and all of their sensitivities and all their proclivities and all their peculiarities. You know that negotiating life with other human beings in partnerships, in relationships, in intimate relationships, in friendship, it is not easy, man. My goodness, can you imagine negotiating those things without guidance from experienced, understanding, knowledgeable people? And then we wonder why sometimes it messes up that way. Right? We need guidance. Children need guidance. Fathers, your children need guidance. And I believe firmly in praying. I believe firmly in praying. I believe, you know, when I listen to preachers preach, I hear a lot of espousing what I call Gnostic eccentricism in scripture. You know, it's almost like you show me how smart you are, so now I know all kinds of things about all kinds of etymology of this word and that word and the next word. But when you listen to Jesus teach, Jesus taught for guidance. How do you deal with a neighbor? Let me show you through this parable. Right? How do you listen? Let me show you through this parable. It's for guidance. Guidance about how to negotiate, how to navigate life. Children need guidance. What's the next thing they need? Okay? So you're giving them some guidance. What's the next thing that you need to help children in this particular day and age have? Somebody, somebody will venture. Yes, let me read some of these texts. Odessa. Okay, that's a UB student. Says me to something because most of the parents today don't give good guidance. It's like the blind leading the blind. It's true, very true. Sign, Mr. Lang, first there must be love for the child. There must be an openness between child and parent to discuss anything. There must be discipline to teach children right from wrong. Also, parents must be aware of everything their child does to be able to keep them from going astray. Those are very good points. That's a very good point. This person says a plan. So you need a plan. Okay, so we need a plan. This person says, sometimes God speaks to others or to you in still small voice. We usually say something tells me to do such and such. It's a mystery. So we need to lead them by example, says that person. We need to lead them by example. We have some other texts here. Says, Mr. Lang, we need to talk about finding ways and means to harness our young boys to being more productive citizens. This turf war in our neighborhood must be addressed urgently. The drug culture of the 80s is creeping back. But that's a description of the problem. We're talking about what it takes to lead them, to guide them now, direct them. It says, fine, regarding God, the child needs guidance, but the parents need wisdom to determine where and how to get and use the guidance, wisdom, passage, information. Yeah, that's the point. And that's why I said the parent, that's where the parent got the guidance from. And ultimately, if you go back for and far enough and far enough and far enough, well, somebody had to get the guidance first. And where's that guidance coming from? I'm saying you need to get it from the creator, right? You know, now we're getting into the subject of religion. Which creator? Which one you mean? Which one you mean? You mean God, the Judeo-Christian God? You mean Muhammad? It's God, Allah? You know, what do you mean? Yeah, that's another discussion. But you do need some guidance. You need wisdom, right? What else does a child need? Right? We're not talking about basic things like food and shelter and stuff like that, because those are biological requirements. Those are obvious things, right? We're talking about to function in this world, right? How about the child needs to develop a productive way of channeling their curiosity. Notice what I said. A child, now you're giving the child guidance. A child will be naturally curious. There's no question about that. They see a hole in the wall. They wonder what that is about. You know it's a socket. They just see a hole in the wall. They wonder what that's about, right? So they have a natural curiosity. They're going to probe. But what we need to be able to do is to never quench that curiosity, never quench it, nurture it, help them to be even more curious so that they, if you're successful in nurturing a child's curiosity, what you do is you end up creating a thirst for knowledge, a thirst for understanding and a thirst for wisdom, and that sets them on the course to an intelligent life. How do you nurture a thirst for curiosity in a child? By creating in their environment curiosity, filling things, books, interesting magazines. You know, you going on YouTube, not just to watch some funny cracked something, but watch something that is telling and giving and providing information, but things that might make them curious, like about animals and how they work, and like plants and how they work in the world and how it works. Because you mightn't think about it, but what happens is they will sit there with you looking bored for a minute, and then they see something interesting. They go, "But daddy, what that? And so forth. By not answering their questions, when they ask you a question, don't answer the question. You say to them, listen, was that you I saw on the internet the other day watching that thing up? Say, yeah, well, why don't you use the same internet to go search or answer for that and come and bring it back to me and let's talk about it. Because now you are trying to execute on that curiosity and define the methods of fulfilling the search that curiosity develops in them. Child needs curiosity. You want your children to be curious about this world, but not only to be curious, to be able to figure out how to get information that fills that curiosity gap. If that child is interested in knowing how sex works, you want to be able to channel them to the right sources. You don't want them in the backyard playing no basketball, hearing some ignorant child tell them how sex works. You don't want that. You want to direct them to the right and proper channel to do so. Don't quench their curiosity. You're too young to hear that. Nonsense. But too young to hear. You are their parent. You are their guardian. You are their guide. Guide them to where they can get appropriate information, useful information about this thing that they are curious about, because you're telling them you're too young to hear, it ain't gonna make them less curious. All you're gonna do is cause them to become more curious, because why is mommy and daddy hiding this from me? Ooh, sugar, let me go find out. Whatever it is they want to find out about, whatever it is, if they want to find out about Satanism and what that is, you be the one who guides them to where they can get and find information about it. Don't be judgmental. Whatever it is. Some of y'all who are religious, if you read David's writings in the Psalms, David used to talk to God like the God, my enemies are mashing me up and you sitting on your throne doing nothing. What kind of nonsense talk is that? God is not offended by those kinds of things, or authentic query about what is happening in the world and life. So children need guidance, but they also need in that guidance to be directed to where their natural curiosity can find fulfillment. Let me tell you something. A curious child who knows how to get information is going to be an intelligent child in the world, and you cannot successfully navigate the present environment that we are in without intelligence. You know what I mean? You cannot. I'm not talking about, no, you have a degree in this and a degree in that. I'm not talking about you have this certificate and that certificate. That's not intelligence I'm talking about. I'm talking about the kind of intelligence that says, I understand what a thing is. That's knowledge. I understand why a thing is, what it does. That's understanding. And I understand how to use a thing for what it is. That's wisdom. That's the intelligence that I'm talking about, by being able to execute on your curiosity in a productive way. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're going to take a break, our final break. When we come back, we'll continue answering the question. What can we do to help nurture our children in this present time? We'll be back after.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today or visit rsabahamas.com line. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
One thing there is no debate about is that BTC has the best rates. Now, the best rates just got better because you pay half the price of the other guys with your BTC home internet and mobile services combined. Switching to BTC is a no-brainer because I pay less with BTC and get super fast internet with speeds up to 600 megs. The other guys, their internet only go up to 105 megs.
Get all the internet you want at half the price when you bundle your home internet and mobile. Visit a BTC store to make the switch today. Conditions apply.
Fidelity. We're good for you.
We know how important collecting your money can be to the success of your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services. From click and pay options online to merchant terminals and e-commerce options. We're here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Tuesday afternoon. If you want to call us, the numbers are 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us at 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp me at 439-3043. So we are asking the question, what does it take to nurture a child in this environment in which we live? We talked about the fact that they need guidance, very good guidance. They need to have their curiosity channeled into productive avenues for satisfaction, right? Because they're going to be curious, and the more curious they are, and the more they can satisfy that curiosity, the more intelligent they could be, the more intelligent they are, the better they can navigate the world in which they live. Someone texted and said they need friends, and they are absolutely right. Now, I want to explain this to you all very carefully. Very carefully. A child comes into the world recently inheriting family, mommy and daddy, at the very least. If the mommy and daddy have children, they inherit siblings, at the very least. They don't choose them. They don't choose them. For some reason, they come naturally to have an affection and a closeness to them. But that don't always be the case. I can't tell you all how stunned I have been over the last 20 years of my life by the fragmentation, absolute horrid relationship that exists between siblings and sometimes parents and children. It is phenomenal. I'm sorry, when I was growing up, I didn't see that a lot. I didn't see it close to me, but man, I've seen so much of it. And all that tells me is, listen, man, being related ain't no guarantee to having a relationship that's wonderful with anybody, being related. But I can tell you this one thing. Nurture a child to cherish and develop friendships, and you will nurture a child who will be more successful on this planet than most children who are not able to do the same thing. Children need to know how to make and keep friends. And how do they do that? By being friendly. And how do you be friendly? You be friendly by being likable and helpful, right? Meaning you become a better friend and have more friends when you know how to treat people. When you know how to handle people, when you know how to care about people right now. Here, I'm gonna tell you this other thing. The people who best know how to deal with other people are the people who know how to befriend themselves. Some of us are the lousiest friends to ourselves that a friend could have. We are hard on ourselves. We are unforgiving on ourselves, man. We are callous with ourselves, man. We Jordan Peterson put it this way. Jordan Peterson, they say, people will have a pet and go to the vet, and the vet will tell them your pet needs to have this prescription in order to get over this particular disease. And they will faithfully go and get the medication from the pharmacy to give the pet and get the pet that until the pet is healed. Those same people will get an antibiotic prescription from the doctor, and the doctor tell them take all until it's finished. And the minute they feel better, they'll stop taking it, which means that they cherish the friendship with the pet better than they cherish the friendship with themselves. And that's us. Somebody, our friends do something to us, yes, we carry that burden for a lifetime. You got to be able to befriend yourself, and you have to be able to befriend people. Let me tell you some folk, listen to me. I would rather have a, in quote, not so smart child who is friendly than a very intelligent child who is unfriendly. Because 80 plus percent of your success in this world is going to be attributed to the way you handle yourself and the way you deal with other people. 80 plus percent, according to research on emotional intelligence. And if you look at what the bulk of the challenges we are having in the world today, these challenges are about the way we deal with each other, the way we deal with ourselves. What is depression? What is anxiety disorder? What is hatred and envy and strife? What is murder? What is rape? They are issues we have with ourselves and issues we have with other people, children. Need to learn how to make and keep friends. I tell my children all the time, I say, let me tell you something, man. If everybody's only inviting you to go someplace and you're not inviting anybody to go someplace, you ain't have no friend. They have a friend. You are their friend. They are not your friend. Because a friend gives a friend you looked to. If the only person getting something out of relationship is you, the other person is your friend, you are not their friend. The other person loves and cares for you, you don't care for them. A friendship can never be a one-way street, and we have to be able to teach children on this planet how to not see only themselves. Okay, that kind of selfishness, that cannot work. It can't work in the most basic of relationships. It can't work parent to child. It can't work child to sibling. It can't work child to friend. It can't work child to mate. It can't work child to colleagues or peers. It can't work child to neighbor. Friendship matters. Friendliness matters. Friendliness. Neighborliness matters. Jesus said, who is my neighbor? And gave the parable and showed, who's your neighbor? It's not important who your neighbor is. The important is, are you prepared to be a neighbor? Because a neighbor wants to help. Text says, see, it is so very important to know who their friends are. This is where the guidance comes in. No, I don't think it's important to know who their friends are as such. Because if you teach a child what a friend is, a child will have friends you can trust. If you teach a child what a friend is, because even if you think you know who the child's friend is, what does that mean? Does that mean that because a child is so-and-so child, okay, let's say that daddy's a drug dealer. Let's say that daddy's a gangster. Okay, what does that mean? What does that tell you? So that child shouldn't befriend that child because their daddy's a gangster drug dealer, that means that's what the child is. Well, I've seen too much instances where that is not the case. What exactly does that mean? What do we really know? You see a child playing with a child. We only know them for a little, we see them for a little while. What do we know about them? What we want to do is teach the child how to measure a friend. And this is the definition I give my kids of friends. The Bible says, as iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of his friend. So I say to my children, if the people you hanging out with make you dull and not sharper, then they are not your friends. A friend is seeking to make you better. A friend is seeking to help you out. No friend is going to encourage you to do something that's going to harm your body or harm your mind or bring you into disrepute, etc. So you teach a child what a friend is. Now you can't make them choose, but that is the condition for it. Because at the end of the day, you can't stop them no how. You can't. Yeah, you can keep them inside the house, but they go to school. Are you there at the school? No, you're not. When they play out in the neighborhood, can you really be sure they're not going to hang out? You know, you can't. We have to teach children discretion. We have to help them at least. We have to help them try to develop discretion and let that discretion be their guide, right? But if you teach them to be friendly, if you teach them what being a true friend is, they will know when somebody is only an associate, an acquaintance, or a neighbor. They'll know that's not my friend. Because I wouldn't hang out with somebody who does that. Or if I do, I'm trying to make them better and they have a willingness to be better and they have a willingness to try to make me better. But you want to give them nurturing and being friendly, right? Being likable. Because the last time I checked, people will shank a lover. But most people don't shank people they like. Right? And then, you know, we're running out of time, but maybe we'll pick this up another day because there's so much more we could talk about to try to help nurture these children in this very complex and interesting environment in which we find ourselves, right? And the is, you can only do your best at it, right? But at least make sure it's your best you're given. And that best means you have to pay attention. You have to really pay attention, right? We really have to pay attention. Some of you, I know some of your children. One of my texters, I know it's her son. And as a young, I met him as a basketball player in Orlando. Let me tell you something, a superb young man, right? And it speaks volumes to the kind of nurturing and guidance he got. And this is what we got to do. And you could tell the attention was paid. And that's what we got to do. We got to pay attention. Where we put our attention is where we direct our energies. And where we direct our energies is where we get most of our results. So if you want to nurture a child in this environment in which we find ourselves, you got to pay attention, John. Pay good attention. Anyway, folks, you all have a great, great evening. You've been listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. Naughty is up next with Talking Heads. We'll talk to you again tomorrow. God's best night.
Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. Send you know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.